can be used to acquaint people with the new members. By having them come up front to introduce them, and maybe by a reception to give people a better opportunity to meet them and get acquainted.
Okay, next one.
No next one.
Hmm?
There's no next one. Unless you want
for more information.
Oh.
For more information on church membership, you might want to check out The Nature of Church by Earl Radmacher, Western Baptist Press, and The Church and God's Program by Robert L. Saucy, Moody Press.
Okay, well, I just wanted to read through that because I know you got to go. And coming back to the membership protects the church and the matter of voting on key issues. That's what you asked me about, right?
Yep.
Yes,
I'm asking you about everything you got down there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I have heard.
I will.
And even been in a situation where people who had not been in the church in years, but was still on the membership roll, were brought in to stack the deck in favor of a certain position or issue. Most importantly, though, it protects the church against people with unsound doctrinal views or views contrary to a church belief and constitution. You'll see this happening a lot of times. Whenever that once a year or twice a year, when it's time to vote on members, vote on officers, something like this, church people who haven't been in church all the year, you got others to go out and tell them, we need you at church because we have an election going on, and we need you to come so you can vote. And they would even ask the person who to vote for. So you got these kind of issues going on in the church. That's why it is important to do membership classes to assure people that this is not acceptable, so they would know that these kind of things is not acceptable. If you're not a faithful attender, if you're not a faithful in honesty and truthfulness, and most people can be honest and truthful in everything until it comes to money. When it comes to money, you'll find people of all levels, preachers, bishops, elders, lay members, everybody else, you'll find many of them dishonest. The Bible says bring all your tithes to the storehouse. When do people, in our experience, when we see and what we hear every day in the church world, in the church community, what do we see? People bring their tithes and offerings when they come to church. If they don't come to church for 2 or 3 weeks, they don't pay no tithes and offering. God don't accept that. God said, bring all of your tithes to the storehouse. He mean all. Was
so,
you, huh?
I'm sorry. So I didn't pay my tithes this week, but they're in my thing, so I don't have to pay my tithes now. Because I can keep my tithes, right? Cause I didn't come to church Sunday because of the storm. I didn't keep mine. Right?
Right. Well, you're going to keep them every year. I didn't come to church Sunday, so I ain't putting nothing in.
Well, I'm not going to do that. I'm bringing mine.
Yeah, I know.
But I know.
Do you got to pay 15% of it, though?
No.
So, this is kind of dishonest that people have that is overlooked.
Uh-huh.
That's what I'm trying to drive home. The dishonesty is a thing that is overlooked.
Well, you know, it was a snowstorm, and you know, I needed some extra vittles and stuff to get, and you know, I didn't have no more money.
I wanted. They don't even bring no excuses. They don't even make no excuses. They don't even bring no excuses. They just don't come. They don't bring no tithes. They don't bring no offering.
And keep it rolling, huh, Pop?
And when they do come, they pick up from
keep on rolling.
They pick up from the day that they come.
Oh my God.
Do you gotta pay 50%?
Hmm?
Do you have to pay 15%?
He told you no. Me and her told you no.
I didn't hear the no.
No.
Part.
No?
So membership,
oh, the
membership class should really have people to understand what these things are, that they don't fall into these snares.
Pastor, okay, so I just came to church and I said that I want to be a member.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
So now I don't come back to 2 months later. What happened?
You come back 2 months later, you expect to come back 2 months later like you never miss out a day.
Mm-hmm.
And this is something it needs to be taught.
Right.
So people will be aware of these things.
Right.
These things are not taught, so people are not aware of them. My people are destroyed.
So you responsible for paying tithes or not?
What was that?
If you're not a member,
you don't talk to me
like that. Often, very often.
Oh, I need to get her question.
You're not responsible to pay tithes.
You're not responsible until you make a commitment.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Oh, you're not responsible.
Commitment, then you're responsible. And that's why you need membership class. When a person comes to be a member, that's when they make their commitment. That's when they understand what their commitment is.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
The Bible said if you don't know.
See, you made a commitment.
No,
am I
doing work?
Am I a member?
The Bible said there is no guilt for those that do not know.
No, they did leave.
So these things need to be taught.
They did.
So people will understand what church life is about. All right?
Yes, sir.
Membership can provide a certain amount of protection in legal matters.
Oh,
what does that mean? Anybody know what legal matters are?
Yeah. You explain
so
that.
How can church membership protect in legal matters?
Well, if you're part of the membership of Living in Jesus Ministry and going by the bylaws, because our insurance takes certain policies and certain things that one would do outside the church, we can help them with that.
Amen.
What?
And it protects because.
Mm-hmm.
If I go before the judge,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not a member of the church or anything, the judge have less respect.
Mm-hmm.
But if I am a member of a church and I have a representative from the church to go to court with me, the judge automatically look at the representative and give respect to the one who he's representing.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even count the time that the judge stopped doing what he's doing and looks over and says, Reverend, who are you here for? Reverend, who are you here with?
Mm-hmm.
I can't count the time that the judge do that. I was in court in Monroe with a young fellow. Mother used to come here, and he was in trouble stealing his girlfriend's mother's car and stuff like that.
Mm.
And he was in trouble, so I went with him. She wanted me to go to court with him. So I got over to the court. I had never met him. When I got over to the court and met him, he had his hands all down on his butt and everything. And so we met, found out what's the name and everything, what the issues and everything. And he and I went into the council room and so we can talk. And I asked him point blank, I said, sir, I'm asking you a question and I need a straight answer. You realize that you're in trouble with the law? Yeah. I says, are you satisfied with being in trouble with the law, or do you want to get free, or do you want to do better, or what is your issue? Well, I want to get free. I want to get this thing off me, everything. I said, you really do?
Yeah.
I said, you think I could help you? Yeah, I believe you can. My mom said you can. I says, you want me to help you? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I said, get your pants up on me. I said, I'll tell you what you do. I said, you go in the bathroom, put your pants up on you, and put your clothes and straighten your clothes up on you. I said, and do some of your hair. I said, and then come back in here, and we're going to talk. And that's what he did. And came back in here, and he and I sat down and talked. And then his mother came. Wanted us, she would come in, because when we was in the council room together, she wasn't allowed in there until we give her permission to come in. Okay. When it's all said and done, and we're sitting in court waiting for the judge to get to him, the judge stopped and he looked over his glasses and he says, Reverend, who are you here to represent? And I told him about it, I called his name, you know. He said, okay. Well, just hold on, we'll get to you in a little bit. When he got to that case, he didn't call us up in the court there. He took us in the chambers.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. He took us in the chambers, and he sit down in his chair in the chambers, and he started talking to the young man. And he told the young man, he said, you see how much people love you? You have the pastor here to help you get yourself straightened out. Are you going to get straightened out, or are you going to just continue in this ugly, stupid stuff? Because this is about the second or third time he'd been before this judge. In fact, he had spent some time in jail waiting for the court. Wouldn't give him no bail. So anyway, that's how you're protected by being a church member.
So on that, you're protected also because the pastor of the church is our shepherd. Mm-hmm. And he's protecting the flock.
Right. Absolutely. And you just read in Hebrew where he's watching for your soul.
Mm-hmm.
Put it.
Now, remember Sister Betty Angel, one of Sister Betty Angel's children was up here in this house that they're rehabbing. And the police caught them all up in there. Some of them jumped out the window. And but had one girl and three or four boys. Anyway, it got two or three of the boys. I went to court with the mothers. Three mothers. I went to the court here in Newburgh with them. The judge again took us in the chamber. He didn't have it. He didn't preside out there on the seat. He took us in the chamber. And when he told them what he told them and gave them the break he gave them, told them, if you don't come before me again in 6 months, all charges will be dropped, and so forth and so on. When he told them all of this, and he referred to them about the pastors here to help you. Now, you know those three mothers walked out of that judge's office and didn't say thank you, judge, or anything. I hushed the one that I really read the name, and I said to her, I said, thank you, judge. She kept right on walking. She kept right on walking. All three of them walked right out the office, I said it for, and I said it so that they would grab it, you know. I said, well, Church, we certainly thank you, and we certainly appreciate all that you've done. We thank you so much. Thought that they would turn and say, yes, we thank you, or something, you know. They walked out and just, you know what they told me outside? That he should have dismissed the charges. They told me the judge should have dismissed the charges. So anyway.
Also, it can help you by, like showing, if you say somebody said you were somewhere where a crime was committed.
Huh?
Also, it can help you by attendance. Because if somebody say you were somewhere where a crime was committed, mm-hmm. but you were in church and they mm-hmm. have a record of your attendance, uh-huh. that also can help you.
Right. Right. Yeah. If that comes to issue, if you get in court, then that will come up. But I had a community service person working for me recently, a couple of weeks, two or three or four weeks ago. And he stayed on the phone all the time. You remember?
Oh, yes.
He stayed on the phone. You have to try and get him to say, excuse me, are you going to stay on the phone or are you going to work? And he stayed on the phone. So when I sent a report in, you know I sent a report in? I told him he was with me for 4 hours, but he was on the phone most of the time, so I give him credit for 3 hours of service. That's what I wrote on his report. Haven't heard from him anymore. He never put in all his time with me. He might have put in with somebody else. So I'm just telling you, you remember when we used to have so many funerals here? You know why we had so many funerals? Because they didn't have no church home.
Right.
They didn't have no church home. So they come to the church. If the family is big, they got to find a church to put them. But if the family is small, they have it in the funeral home. Mm-hmm. They have it in the chapel at the funeral home. So these are the kind of things that church membership pays off. You got people walk around, have no instruction, no guidance. And because if they was in church, in classes, they would learn. You have never seen so many people dying today without insurance, without life insurance. Every time you look around, people dying. If you talk to the undertaker, he shakes his head. How people are dying, having no life insurance. Being young, like these young people, they get life insurance very cheap. But you know they'd rather spend their money on electronics, iPods, doobabs, hobbies, and all these kind of stuff, rather than to pay that $20-something a month